No, I'm not trying to be rude, but hey, pretty girl, I'm feeling you. The way you do the things you do remind me of my Lexus coupe. That's why I'm all up in your grill, trying to get you to a hotel. You must be a football coach, the way you got me playing the field. Now it's like murder, she wrote, once I get you out them clothes. Privacy is on the door, still they can hear you screaming more. Girl, I'm feeling what you're feeling, no more hoping and wishing. I'm about to take my key and stick it in the ignition. Can I get a everywhere, as if the party was catered. We got fellas to my left, honeys on my right. Bring them both together, we gon' drinking all night. And after the show, it's the after party. After the party, it's the hotel lobby. And around about 4, gotta clear the lobby. Take it to your room and somebody. Do you like drugs? Do you like drugs?
All right, I think we're just about ready. Maybe two more minutes to go, and then we begin. All right, hello everyone. I hope you can hear me okay. This is, I think, my second live streaming session. I'm finally able to do live streaming after getting my internet connection sorted out to a suitable speed. So today we're going to talk about the one of the kind of pet peeves of mine, which is the Bloomberg terminal. I'm going to bring up a picture of what it looks like. Basically, a Bloomberg terminal is a computer. So it's only a certain amount of services that's put on top, but ultimately there is a monitor or a set of monitors. Well, here we have two monitors, for example, and there is the keyboard, and the keyboard is kind of like the highlight of the whole thing in the sense that it is a trading keyboard. It's a keyboard that's used for trading rather than, ordinary programming or whatever you want it to be. So the we're not going to do anything with regards to keyboard, but we are going to talk about the interface of the terminal itself. Because if you look at the image, and this is the image that I've put up as the cover to this screencast, what you're going to find is that this image is actually, well, it feels kind of almost like if you're in DOS mode and you're having everything in a sort of console mode. So this actually isn't console mode. You can see that there are like little sliders here. So presumably you would be expected to use the mouse and not just the keyboard. But I'm personally of the opinion that it's better to have the keyboard there as well. So let's jump into code. So this is a very old piece of infrastructure that I've been using for quite some time for all sorts of monitoring. And first of all, I wanted to show what it actually is and how it was made. And it is made using old technology. And then maybe we can write some code and actually improve it or talk about some of the ways in which this is done. But I'm going to begin by basically explaining what this is. And what better way than to actually run the program and see what it actually does. So this is it's just going to pop up right here. There is nothing particularly miraculous going on right now. I have just a bunch of numbers that are being streamed to the console, and they're kind of different. Some of them are green, some of them are yellow, some of them are red, and also cursive as well. So no particular magic going on here, except that this whole thing, this what you're looking at right now, is not really the Windows console. It's not the native operating system console. Instead, it's a console that I have personally built myself. And as a consequence of that, this is something that is highly customizable simply because, well, because you can do all sorts of wonderful things in it. So I'm sure you can realize why this is being built. The reason it's being built is because you can, if you think about the Windows console, the common kind of, let me fire up just the ordinary CMD. The thing about this is that there is only one buffer and there is only one viewport within this entire console. So essentially, it is multi-threading friendly in the sense that if you have several threads writing to the console, they're going to be okay. Generally, you can write to the buffer from multiple threads, but it's just a single buffer. You can sort of, if you go into the properties, you will see that when you specify the screen buffer size, there is just one single screen buffer, which isn't great because maybe you want to do more. So this console, the console that I've built, is essentially a multi-view and multi-buffer console. It's as if I was, using design pattern books to build something that's more extensible. So let me show you something. If I type in something on the keyboard, can you see this part? This part down below. So this is a separate viewport, and I'm, as I enter the keystrokes, I'm typing into a separate buffer. So this is the way that you can actually have different parts of your overall design being attached to different systems, different trading systems, different notification systems, or you know, if you're using something like XMPP or any kind of notification mechanism, you can wire that up. So let's take a look at the code, because the code is fairly interesting, even though I must give a warning right now that the system we're using, the system that I'm using to build this, is actually called Manage DirectX. You can see it here, Microsoft DirectX Direct3D. Now, apart from not being portable, which I'm sure you've guessed by now is a not so much a feature of the system as a downside, apart from that, one of the key aspects is that this API, the Microsoft DirectX API, is deprecated. I mean, Microsoft no longer supports it. I think it could be something like 4 or 5 years old, or maybe more. And we do have I wouldn't say that we have a an up-to-date DirectX API that is, you know, usable, but the thing is, DirectX by itself has not been evolving so much, so it doesn't really matter what we're using. The only difference, the only key thing that you'll find if you're looking at the code, is in app config, you'll see that there is the you know, the legacy V2 activation thing being used, because the assemblies are actually .NET 2.0. So that's the only difference that you're ever likely to see, and the rest of it is just, well, it works, basically. So let me explain what the idea is. So instead of a single console, like the console that you see here, for example, so instead of a single console like this with a single buffer, we have an idea of a viewport and an idea of a buffer, and then a console which contains several viewports and indeed several buffers. So let's talk about the buffer first of all. So the buffer is where you put the text in. So when you want to make a buffer, you specify the size, and then you create, well, you suddenly have the text buffer. This is where the text is stored. So as you write your characters, you're writing them into a rectangular grid, or a matrix, if you will, of different characters. And then, of course, we have an additional buffer for the format. I can't quite tell you why it's using a short here. I don't recall why this is being done. Certainly, we're not going to have so many things here as to require it to be short, but the format buffer basically specifies what you can, how the text is rendered. So typically the ordinary Windows console, it can use color, but you cannot make your font italic, you cannot make it boldface, none of that. So here we customize it quite a bit. And then, of course, we have this idea of an insertion point. That's the point where you type in your actual code. And then, of course, we have the guts of the system. So a buffer has a width and a height, and that determines the size of, well, the size of the buffer, and therefore the size of the both the text buffer and the format buffer. And what we do then is we just allow, so we provide methods for doing all sorts of things. First, you can handle keyboard input. So if somebody types something in, you can write it here. And you can also just have an API for like writing a line or something to that effect. When you write something, it's not as easy as you might imagine, because we have a buffer. So we need to write text in the context of a buffer. And this can get very interesting for, you know, wrapping or line breaks on words and this sort of thing. We also have a reader-writer lock slim that ensures that we're not reading stale data and whatever. So there is some thread safety here that allows us to basically write from separate threads. So of course, the question is, how do you present a buffer? Because a buffer can be any size. It can be 1,000 by 1,000 characters. And so we have the concept of a viewport. Now, the viewport is essentially something that presents a buffer at a particular location on the screen, and it takes a particular chunk of the buffer. So essentially, you take a size which defines how big the viewport is. So imagine the buffer itself can be massive. It can store hundreds of lines of text, but the viewport has to fit on the screen. And our screen is kind of limited. We're limited by what we have here. And when I fire up the actual, you know, application that it builds, you can see that there is maybe about 30 lines vertically and maybe about like 60 or 70 columns horizontally. So there isn't much space for us to do anything, to be honest. So that's that's why you control the size of the buffer, and then control the size of the viewport rather. And then the viewport is just a projection. What this means is that the viewport basically has an operator. This, so you basically have the square brackets, which you provide the x and the y for what you want to get. So kind of like the offset, and that gets you the part of the buffer. But notice the changes here. So we adjust it by buffer location, and we also, you know, wrap it and all the rest of it. Yeah, we do have wrapping. It kind of makes sense for a console to generally wrap things around. It's a sensible thing. So finally, we have the buffer. We have the viewport. The question is, well, where do we actually show it? And the answer is that it's a console. So the console is a form. So we're using System Windows Form simply because, well, it's easy. And then, of course, within this, quite a bit of stuff happens. So we have factory methods for actually creating the entire console. You can make a full screen console. You can specify the character width and the height. And of course, the character width and height are actually textures. So this is a key difference to if you are using, let's say, GDI or something to that effect, where you would render the lines of text. Here, none of this happens because we're in DirectX. So what we're doing is we're essentially making, using the texture manager, we're essentially making a texture for each of the elements that we might want to render, and it's just a list. Notice it's not even an associative array, and we limit ourselves by 256 characters, which means that we can only render Latin characters. We cannot render like Russian characters, let alone something like Japanese characters or general Unicode. And I am totally okay with it because, well, for my purposes, I don't need any of this stuff. But if that's really needed, then you can sort of expand it here. But each of these characters gets rendered as a texture, and this texture has to be made. Basically, you have to make a texture. I'm trying to find the exact location where those textures are actually manufactured, because that's interesting. All right, so here is the idea with formatting. So we have presets, like you can have white text or you can have blue bold text, and each of these is a preset that you can define. So you specify your background color, your foreground color, you specify the font that you want to make, and then you add a preset. And this is where the fun begins, because what we basically do is we make a bitmap. You know, this is an ordinary .NET bitmap, and then we basically write a texture to that bitmap. So we draw a string using the underlying .NET API. I suppose that at this point, what I should be putting as a to-do is I should be using Direct2D, because that's faster and also maybe more precise. But in our case, it doesn't really matter because we only do it once. We do it at startup, and it's reasonably fast compared to everything because you only do it once. So what does it matter, to be honest? So when we do the bitmap, we save the bitmap in a memory stream, and then we create a texture right from the stream. So we turn this bitmap, which is maybe like 10 by 14 pixels typically, at least it is in my demonstration, and we save it and we turn it into a texture. We assign it to our texture array, and we add that array as the preset. So the final thing to put everything together in the console is that you have several of viewports in a list. So you have a list of viewports, and you have to render each of the viewports, and the rendering happens in an aptly named function called render, and the exact stuff happens in render console. You can see that there's plenty of Direct3D stuff here. So render console does we're using Direct3D, to be honest, but we are rendering it in two dimensions because it's a flat thing. I'm sure you can imagine that by tweaking these coordinates and everything, we can make it look as three-dimensional as you want it to be. But the end result is that we render each of the textures in turn. And the way it's done is you just set the texture for whatever letter you have to do. And you can see that the level of indirection here, like the two sets of square brackets. So the level of indirection is that you get the viewport, and then you get the actual character. And so that way you grab the texture, you set the texture, And then you draw a primitive, just a, you know, an ordinary kind of two triangles, which you put the texture on top of. And that's it. That's pretty much all you have to do. Then there's a couple of transforms, and that's really it. So let's see if we can go back to the demo and somehow manipulate it. So, for example, if we try to do 20 by 28 in terms of the character size, we can try running this. And I cannot predict that everything will go perfectly, because typically kind of functions on operating instructions that are default. But you can see here that I've made the textures twice as big. And now we have a window which is twice as big. In fact, we have a window which is, you know, it doesn't even fit the overall scheme here. So let me close that for a second. I'll explain how the multi-threading works, because that's by itself interesting. So the console is programmed to be multi-threaded, sort of by definition. You don't really have to do anything to make it so, because I have a read-write lock on the buffers. And then what happens is we can create a default view and buffer for the console, or alternatively, we can make our own buffer, and both of these are available. So here I make a buffer which is 10 by 10 characters. I make a viewport from the buffer, and I can specify sort of the buffer location and the size here. By the way, this constructor should probably assign some of these things automatically, and I think it does. So if you don't have a, if you're not providing a size, it will assign buffer size, and all the points would be zero. So strictly speaking, some of these operations, like the buffer location, let me jump back to where it was. So the buffer location and the screen location, having them as zero is something that, well, with screen location, we've moved it down. So let me get rid of this. And the size here, once again, I think we kind of inferred from the buffer size. You can see it here. So once again, maybe I can remove this and still have it working. So let me jump back to having it as 10 and 14. I think these are kind of magic sizes that works. Here is the width of the console, for example, so I can sort of change it to a different argument. And then, of course, we make the console itself. So we do console.create. We add any additional viewports that we need. We can specify some text for the window, because remember, it's the console is actually a form. So if I kind of go back up as soon as I figure out how to navigate this whole thing, better do it this way. So the constructor, we want the actual type. So here it is. So we inherit from form, and we're not doing much in the code behind. I don't think there is any code behind. There is no designer.cs for this one, because we're handling everything. So the console, being a window, you can handle a key press. And a key press here is handled by a buffer write. So I'm writing to a particular buffer. And this is why when you actually run the console and you start typing things, this is where the input actually happens. So as I type in here, this is the area where the magic happens insofar as the input is concerned. And we can actually control this, because one of the things that you might want to do instead of writing directly to the buffer is you might want to handle this key press in some of the viewports. So let's actually do that for change. I'm going to jump to key press. This actually this is going to get like the PDB for System Windows Forms. But the reason I want it is because I want the signature, and I want to replicate the signature right inside the viewport. Because what we can do then is we can say, well, by the way, you know, let's have this option of handling key presses in all of the viewports. And then the viewport can decide what the viewport actually wants to do about the whole thing. Because, well, you can inherit from a viewport specifically, and you can do something with it. So here we go. We're now navigating to hopefully the decompiled sources that we got from reference source. I cannot guarantee, once again, I hope that's what happens, but it really doesn't matter. All I want is just to grab the exact event handler. So the add and remove, I think, are automatic. What we can do is we can copy the key press event handler, and then we can go to the viewport. All right, and we can just stick it in here. So, like so, and just like that. Okay, so we now have an event that is may or may not be invoked depending on the situation. We actually another question is, you know, if you create, see ReShopper, it says create event invocator, so maybe we should have like an on key press thing here. So now that we have on key press, what we can do theoretically is we can, well, not theoretically, what we can do in practice is we can say, well, let's go through each of the viewports in my viewports. Wait a second. This is interesting. So the because yeah, we're inside the console. So inside each of the console viewports, and what we can do is we can say viewport dot, and then key press with the underscore and the key. I suppose I should rename it back to sender now that we're actually using it for something. So sender it is. Okay, so why is it complaining? The key press can only appear on the left and right. Oh yes, it's on key press because that's the function that we made, and then we should make it public as well. And what is it? At parameter sender key press event args. So jumping back to the viewport, dum da dum. So we have a sender, and okay, so well, we can proxy the sender here if that's really needed, which I'm not sure it is. So the end result is now each of the viewports that we're operating on is actually able to handle a key press. And what this means, among other things, is that you can inherit and somehow override this whole thing, because it's virtual and you can do all sorts of wonderful things. So let me show you just how that would work typically, or at least an example of how that would work. So if you imagine a class here called my viewport, and let's imagine that this viewport it inherits from a ordinary viewport. So let's inherit it like so, and we have to implement the constructor, because unfortunately you see we cannot use the default constructor at all. So we use the viewport just as we did previously, and then we can say sort of my viewport here. That's probably the only change that we would make, because it's polymorphic. And now what we can do is we can say, oh, by the way, you know, if there's going to be a key press anywhere, I'm going to handle it with my own thing, and my own thing is going to maybe increase the size of the viewport, or increase the size of the buffer, or indeed both. So you can sort of we can try it like this. So I can say, for example, well, by the way, buffer dot how should we do it, actually, is a question, because I don't support dynamic buffer resizing. It's really a dangerous notion in and of itself, because you have to kind of reposition things, and that's not very nice. But what we can do at the very least is we can try something. We can write a letter plus e dot key char plus maybe another character here. Okay, so what is the problem with the buffer? So now we're seeing that a lot of the things that we made private should actually be protected. Maybe everything, maybe this whole thing. Let's use the Visual Studio's column editing mode to make it protected. There we go. Okay, so now that should hopefully be better, and we can actually try this. We can actually try running and see what ends up happening, because I think I wired it to the right place. So let's see. Yeah, you can see as I type things, I add these custom handlers to my buffer. So what this means is that if you've got a stream from like anywhere, if you've got a stream coming in from somewhere, then you can process this stream and have your own inherited construct. And I suppose we need to do the same thing for the buffer that we did for the viewport, because it's kind of important to be able to inherit things. And I think we, as API designers, we often forget how to properly design APIs. So let me look at the buffer for a change. And it's okay to sort of protect people from editing some of the some of the things, but keeping stuff private is a bad idea. So once again, I'm going to use the column editing mode here and make it protected. There we go. All right. So let's see what else here is private. I can actually, if I can dig up the file structure window, that should probably be a lot more helpful than whatever it is that I'm planning to do. And the windows here that like really slow. I mean, seriously, Visual Studio, it's just, there we go, the file structure window. Okay, so the green thing presumably means that it's protected. I'm looking for something where there's like a key, and let's try this internal right. Oh no, that the green key is protected, so the lock is private. So some of these, maybe I see no reason to have them as fully private, because when you make something private, I think that's it actually. There's one more. There's the return. I don't know why this is private of all things. It just makes no sense really. So protected. One of the things that you have to watch out for is, you know, users of your API who might need it for whatever reason, and you don't have it, you're not giving them that functionality. All right, so now we have cleaned up some of the visibility, but what are we going to do about the whole building interfaces? Because ultimately, just kind of reiterate the kind of stuff that we want to do, we want to, for example, make the headers, and we want to, well, I'll talk about charts and all the rest of it at some other point in time, because in the moment it's just a desire to basically write some of the information in a table format, for example. Now a table format is a different kind of buffer. It's not the same kind of buffer as what you're used to. So, and it's a fairly common thing. It's a fairly common, you know, definition of stuff. So we need some other way of doing it. And the way that we do it is by using a different buffer and a different console. So at the moment, the kind of buffer that we have, I suppose we could rename it to simple buffer. And the reason we would do that is because, well, it's a simple buffer that just has a rectangular array. Simple buffer. There we go. However, the kind of thing that we, I hope this rename refactoring goes through okay. I'm not going to rename any of the related symbols because it's just a buffer, whatever it is. And none of these probably, so you see this reshopper going through like every single symbol and saying, oh, you're using a buffer here. So let's not do that. Okay, next. All right, so here is a rename. I hope this builds after I perform the rename. Actually, I should probably check this just to make sure. Once this goes through, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make an entirely different buffer, and then we'll talk about some of the polymorphic behaviors that we can kind of implement, because the buffer I want to make is essentially a table buffer. So a table buffer is also a rectangular environment of sorts, but not quite. It's not quite the same thing, because you'll see that some of the things are right aligned. For example, they're aligned to the right of the column, and some of the things are left aligned and whatnot. So at the simplest level, if we go and we actually make, well, not this, let's make a new class. I'm going to call this one a table buffer. So a table buffer is going to be exactly what we want, and it's going to store some sort of data. At the moment, it's really difficult to say what kind of data it's going to store because if you look at this table, this little table right here, you'll see that the first column is strings, and the second column is double values, and the third column is also double values. So essentially, if we had variadic templates, which we don't, then we could strongly type it to any kind of dimension, shall we say. Unfortunately, because we don't have that capability, I would start by doing it in terms of strings. So the way to do it, typically, if you want a specification, so if you want some sort of a constructor which makes a table buffer based on the specification, then you would have to specify two things for each of the columns. So let's have some inner class. Why is it static all of a sudden? I don't want a static class. Just an ordinary class called table column spec. So this is a specification for a table column. We're going to define some things. Actually, I'm going to do it the old-fashioned way. Let's have a value type, and then we'll have public fields here. So what do we want to have with respect to the table column specification? Well, we want to have the maximum width. That's kind of critical. Maximum width, because, well, it should probably be an unsigned int, max width. All right, notice I like using unsigned types here. Well, width can all be negative, or, well, it can be zero, but we have to complain if it is zero. So the maximum width is what it's going to take. Actually, we should probably just use width instead of maximum width, because, well, whatever happens, we have to process it. The other one is alignment. And I'm not sure there is ever going to be a situation where we have to center align something. But just in case we do, I'm going to make yet another enum. And actually, these enums, well, we can certainly keep them public. So let's have a public struct called table column alignment. Okay, so at the moment I'm going to have the obvious values. Oh, wait. Enum, not struct, left, center, and right. Okay, so the next public field is going to be table column alignment. Alignment. There we go. Okay, so we have the width and we have the alignment, and that's it. Pretty much, because it's still going to be a grid of sorts, but it's going to be a essentially a rectangular table of strings. Because quite frankly, we're not going to be so obsessed with just stay tuned for this one. So table buffer. When you make a table buffer, you need to specify some sort of. You need to provide a table column specification. How do you provide an array? Oh, obviously not like this. This is C#. Table column specification. And this is something that we're going to store as a field somewhere. So this defines what the table columns actually are. However, we forgot one thing. And the thing we forgot is the header. Header. So the header is, for those of you who are living on another planet, the header is the thing that appears here at the top. And at the top of the respective header. We can have a global header as well if we really want. So the public string blah 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 blah. What is it? Header. There we go. Okay. We have these as private, but maybe some validation could be useful, because, well, it kind of makes sense. But okay, let's not do that for now. Okay, so we have a specification. What else do we need apart from the specification? We need to specify the amount of data that's going to be stored in there, meaning we need to specify the number of rows that the table is actually capable of storing. And this is yet another question that is totally unanswered, because remember, we are working within the confines of a specific buffer. And among other things, the buffer has to specify its size, and this is a tricky point, because you see, when you after you make a table buffer, what you need to do is you need to be able to provide definitively what its size is. And certainly here we have a protected size. However, we have to override this whole thing. We have to somehow reduce our... So essentially what we have to do for the simple buffer is we have to extract a certain amount of information into a base class, which would allow us to get just the specifics, just some of the sort of core aspects. And so if we think of the area that we need to initialize for this, we may as well keep just a string array here. So... this is going to be something like this: private read only list of. Okay, this is yet another question. How exactly do we want to store it? So each of the rows may as well be an element in the list, but the exact columns are going to be an array of particular size. So why not? I mean, this is going to be our buffer effectively. So this is where we need to initialize that thing. So the buffer itself is easy. So the buffer is a certain number of items, and the number of items has to be provided here. We have to provide the number of rows, but remember that in addition to the rows, we have to account for the headers. So if somebody says 10 rows, does that include the headers or not? So we may as well give a hint by saying total, well, we can say total height. So then the number of actual elements in the buffer would be total height minus 1. Total height minus 1, there we go. Okay, so that's our buffer with the total height minus 1 number of elements. And then for each of the elements, we also have to initialize the string array. And we know what to initialize it to because, well, to be honest, it's really anything goes, except that we maybe want to have, we maybe want to initialize it so that we just overwrite things in the future as opposed to, you know, pad stuff out. So for each of the elements, or for each of the elements in the buffer, int I equals 0, i is less than how much? Buffer dot length or buffer dot count plus plus I. This is where we create the arrays, the actual arrays. Hooray, this should be fun. Okay, so the buffer at the element I is assigned to a new string array, and the number of strings here corresponds to the number of elements in the specification. So that's spec.length. There we go. Now that we have a set of elements in the buffer, what we need to do is maybe initialize each of them. So that's something that is also particularly painful. Actually, I'm going to avoid doing it right now. So because all we care about is the indexer. And I don't even know if the indexer can be part of some inheritance or not. That remains to be seen. Because what we're going to do is jump to the simple buffer and attempt to extract interface. And by the way, I hate regions. Remove region directives in the entire file. Ta-da! Fantastic. Okay, so let's try extracting the interface somehow and getting only the parts that we actually need for this sort of thing. So let's go to extract interface, and let's look at some of the things that we want to... Oh, wait, it's not extract interface. Well, actually... it could be like an iBuffer. An iBuffer interface. So some of the things that we might want to have generally, and I'm going to change this list later on, but it's the accessor to the actual buffer. We do want that. Apart from that, at the moment, I'm kind of going to ignore everything. I don't know why there is a two string in there, but I'm going to basically keep this as is, because that's the indexer is what we need to actually render something. So there we go. Ta-da! So now we have an interface called iBuffer, and it just so happens that TableBuffer also has to have an iBuffer interface implementation, and let's implement the missing members. And this is where things get tricky. I mean, really tricky. Okay, so we need to be able to get and set the buffer, which may sound simple, except it's not. So getting something from a buffer is relatively simple. Let's do that first. So the x coordinate actually determines the position that you have to get from the ultimately the whole thing horizontally, and the y coordinate gets us the row. So if we talk about the y coordinate, there are two cases. So if y is equal to 0, then we need the header. So we need the column header. Otherwise, just the data item. Okay, so here is the thing. Let's suppose that you decide that you want a column header at a particular position. Where does that actually fall? So how do we determine that? Right. So we go through each of the We go through each of the columns, and we have the spec here. So if you, for int I, well, let's call it int s for spec. Int s equals 0, s less than spec.length, plus plus s. Okay, so we go through each of the elements, and we basically check the width and whether or not it's been reduced. So I'm going to make a copy of the x. X copy equals x, because now I'm going to reduce it by that amount. So if the specification at this particular point is greater than what we have left in X copy, then we have to print something. So if the specification at S width is less, or indeed equal, actually no, it's probably less than X copy, then we print the character, or return the character. Return the character. Otherwise, and this is the easier case, we move on to the next column. So we say x copy minus equals spec s dot width, and we simply continue the for loop. That's how it goes, except, yeah, this is x copy. Okay, so what is the, oh, right. Cannot convert source type long to target type int. Well, fine, I can have a long. What do I care? I don't know how we got a long in there. Oh, okay, fine. It's a uint. I could have done a uint as well. You can sort of mess around. But this is an int, so fine. You can have a long. I don't care about the type conversion here. Okay, so at this point, if we're out of space, so to speak, then we have to return the character at position x. And that is, or should be, rather easy, because we recalculate the actual y-coordinate based on the fact that we do have headers. But at the moment, we are outputting headers. So we return, and this is where things get tricky again, because here's the thing. What if the requested element is further along than the size of the header? What do you do then? So if obviously the header is null, or the header size isn't sufficient enough to cover the x value. So if the header, actually let's extract it. Do I want to extract it? Well, yeah, I suppose I do. So introduce variable header, yeah. Okay, so if the header is null, or if the header length is less than the coordinate that we want. So for example, the header length can be 1, and if we request the coordinate 1, okay, that's 1 plus then, 1 plus x. Then what we return is just, I don't know, space. That's the simplest thing that we can render, just a space. Otherwise, this is where we return header at the coordinate x. So this covers the header part, but it does not cover the rest of the show, meaning the data items, because that's where the fun is. And we actually have, well, we can have an adjusted y value. At the moment, I don't really feel like doing anything in the setter at all, because, well, it's complicated, and we're doing a live stream which can last maybe about an hour or so. So provided that we have a data item, we can actually print this data item if we can figure out where it actually is. So the once again, the x-coordinate search is going to be the same as before, meaning that we're going to have a similar kind of loop with long x copy equals x, and then if for int s equals 0, s is less than spec.length, plus plus s. So for each of the actually in this case, yeah, we're still going through the specification, each of the elements in the specification, but the width is still relevant. So once again, we have kind of cut and paste here, kind of code that's being copied, but I'm deliberately copying it so we can actually figure out what's going on. So this, if the spec width is less than X copy, then we do a different thing to what we did here. So here we just got the header. But unfortunately, in our case, in the case where we are right now, we cannot get a header. And at the moment, I'm going to assume that all the data is aligned to the left, because if it's not, it's a completely different story as to how it gets written and all the rest of it. So with that in mind, what we're going to do is we're going to, well, first of all, grab the item, var item equals spec. So we actually don't need the spec because the data item is stored in this buffer. So the buffer itself is the a list, right? So buffer, and then we take the row plus one. So that would be y plus one, because y zero is the columns. So buffer y plus one, that gives us an array of strings. And then for each of the strings, what we can do is we can actually, you know, figure out if we're, well, we know that we're hitting the string. So with that in mind, we can figure out with the, hold on. So let me do the else case, first of all. So in the else case, just like here, we're essentially reducing X copy by the length, and we're sort of proceeding in our pursuit of the final thing. So X copy spec at S dot width. So reduce it this way. However, at this point, we already know that we are at the right location. So the buffer at a particular location will give us an array of strings. Okay. Although this is not the right, this is not the right way of doing it, because we need to effectively, let me see, spec at S. Oh, so the S, yeah, of course, I'm sorry. So in actual fact, we specify the index S here, and then we specify the position of the actual string, which in our case is X copy. And that is what we return, I think. Return. We can sort of verify this later on, because, oh yeah, we forgot another thing. So a buffer is a list of string arrays. If we index into that, we get a string array. If we index into the actual string that we have to get, wait. This is y plus one. This is S, and this is X copy. And the reason why X copy doesn't work is because it is a long list not assignable to a type of int, which, see, this is, you try to be clever, but in the end, what you end up doing is reverting your own changes and going into the table buffer and putting things back because you used a uint instead of an int somewhere. And now I can't even, there we go. Okay, let's live with a signed value, and now everything is okay. So magically everything is okay. Although it says 3 errors in 2 files here. I think these are false positives, definitely. All right, so we have a table buffer that can subsequently be specified to contain something or other, and we kind of print it from left to right. Can we actually render it though? Because now what happens is if we go back into the console, we now need to deal not so much with an array of physical buffers as an array of iBuffer interfaces. So if we jump into the console, what you'll see is that we have iList of viewports, and each of the viewports is actually bound to like a simple buffer. So let's see what happens, and this is going to break everything if I do it like this. iBuffer. Hooray! So now it's iBuffer here as well, and we can use solution-wide analysis to find many errors. Like, for example, here is the size. So we immediately want to calculate the size of the whole thing. And you can see that there is like simple buffer all over the place. So you put an I in here and just search for, just searching for simple buffer. I just want to see some of the locations where it's used, because it's interesting where I made these kind of, it's not really an error, it's more like refactoring design. So control home, control H, simple buffer, 2i buffer, replace all. Oh, wait. No, it's not in current project, it's just in the current document. Okay, so I replaced two occurrences. And I don't imagine that this is going to work, because some interface members are missing. And one of those is size. So what this means is that somewhere inside iBuffer, well, what it means is that you have to jump into simple buffer and then extract some of the stuff out. So effectively, we can just pull members up. If I go and look for size, there we go, size with a capital S. Here we go. So, how would I do it? Like, can I just push members up? And if I push members up and choose size here, what would that do? Okay, I'm gonna try it, because I don't know exactly what the. Okay, so if I do Alt Home now, haha. Okay, so plenty of crazy stuff here, like a protected internal set where this thing is not even, you know, it doesn't require visibility. And size really, I'm not sure if we need a setter on the buffer by itself, because typically there is like a constructor thing that you can call if you want to do that. So maybe the protected, maybe the set should be protected as well. Or not. I mean, the accessibility might, yeah, you're, seriously, I don't remember any of this stuff, but never mind. So all I care about on the interface is being able to find out the size of the buffer so I can do something about it. And that means that in our table buffer, we have to specify that size. And this is going to be another tricky thing to do generally, because see, it's now all red and it's saying, oh, implement these members. And okay, right. So size, what is the size of the buffer? Well, it's actually easy. Return new size. All right, so the width of the buffer is the sum of the spec widths, and the height of the buffer is total height, which, by the way, we should probably just cache just instead. Instead of calculating it every time. So the size in terms of the width is spec dot sum s goes to s dot width. And the height of the buffer is total height. That's it for size, but unfortunately that's not the only thing that we actually have to fix, because, well, there are other issues out there, and we can sort of, there's even a red bar here saying that we are not. Oh, we forgot to, yeah. So here's the thing. We basically, for this entire for loop, we are expecting that at some point, the x value is going to be reduced by the spec width. And it's saying, well, by the way, what if it doesn't? And I know it will, but if it doesn't, let's just return an empty space like we did previously. So I don't imagine that this will compile, because we still have plenty of errors. And one of those errors is, you can see here that the buffer essentially needs more stuff. It needs, for example, a start line and a buffer location. These are some of the things that might tempt me to actually change an interface into a concrete class, surprisingly enough. Because I mean, there is no real problem with doing this sort of thing. So let's just look where start line is on the simple buffer. Start line, there we go. So you can see that there is plenty of magic here, but ultimately it's just a get for where something gets rendered, and subsequently the it's the index of the starting line, because what happens is buffers, they kind of circle around. If you scroll them, it's completely irrelevant in our case. So in our case, once again, what we can do is we can bring up a refactoring and pull members up, and we can say, well, okay, start line. What do I want? I want start line to be in the interface. And now that it's in the interface, we can go into the table buffer. And now we're once again missing something. So let's go into the type and implement missing members. And this time, yeah, it's this. So just return a zero here because there is no notion of insertion. So there is no notion of a start line. Let's get back to the viewport. Plenty of problems here, I'm afraid. Let's press another one. Okay, so what else is here? What else is buffer.startLine? And okay, no, I'm not getting this. So let me just give me a moment to read this. The indexer has no setter. Okay, that's literally what it says. The indexer has no setter, and let me go to where is it? Oh, we didn't even put it to a separate file. Shame on me. I should be like punished for this. Let's move to ibuffer.cs. We did not specify a set here because, you know, somebody might want to actually write to this buffer, and who knows? I mean, it's legal for some cases. It's not so legal for the case that we're dealing with. Although I do want to write to the underlying buffer. So is that it? Are we done? I don't think we're done, to be honest. I mean, let's look at simple buffer. Now it's complaining that non-public accessor cannot implement accessor. So let's fix the visibility because, yeah, I guess we had it at protected or something like that. Protected internal, maybe. Okay, so what happens here? My viewport. Oh, yeah. Well, you see, here is what happens. You try to write to a buffer, but not all buffers are writable directly. And this is certainly a valid complaint. So I'm going to get rid of this for now and get rid of the whole my viewport thing and just use an ordinary viewport because we have plenty of problems to deal with apart from this problem. Okay, so once again, these are simply interface hiccups because in the console itself, we have to also replace simple buffer with an iBuffer. Let's do everything. Six occurrences replaced, and that hopefully that fixes some of the errors and then proposes some of the others, because what you see here is that when we create a default buffer, that should really be a simple buffer because that's what the purpose of the simple buffer was to begin with. So now we're kind of reversing some of the changes that I made previously, and that could be annoying. By the way, here is a cast from, well, no, it's not a cast anymore because now we have an array of interfaces, so that's okay. Write format on the console is is it being used somewhere? Let me shift F12. Oh dear. Right, this is annoying because we write into the console assuming that there is some default buffer there that we can write to, but what if the buffer is not writable? That's the problem. And we actually have several situations where we're writing to the console buffer. So I think that what we're going to do is we're going to destroy this method completely. All these write format, write line, everything of this nature is basically going to go into the buffers. You should not be able to write through the console, even though it's very useful. I understand that, you know, there is a way of there is a way of dealing with it in the sense that, for example, you can say that, I can certainly put like curly braces here, and I can say, oh, by the way, we're going to check if the console is if the buffer is a simple buffer. If it is a simple buffer, then yeah, go ahead and write something to it. So, for example, I can say var buffer equals this thing. Copy and paste as simple buffer. And I can say if buffer, then yeah, you can write to it. But this is so ugly and so bad for a number of reasons. Buffer. There we go. Oh, wait, somebody's already using buffer, so let me make it B. What? B. And B here as well. Okay, this is now legal. We still have just a few problems to deal with, mainly accessing the format buffer as well. So this is problematic for us. And also some of the things that have like insertion points. The insertion point is actually something that we do not need for the table buffer. So you see that it's just a point. So once again, I can bring up the pull members up thing and pull it up to the iBuffer. And then, of course, if I go into the table buffer, I can implement it. But this time, I'm not going to give it values of 0 and 0, because that will actually draw the insertion point at point 0 and 0. So instead, what I'm going to do is return invalid point. Or I wonder if there's some point that's already invalid here. Point.empty. No, this has value set to 0. So invalid point. And that's going to be a field that I'm going to make. I can actually make it const. Can I make const objects? Not sure. A new point, minus 1, minus 1. Static read only. Okay, I can live with a static read only field. Although, you know, I don't see what the problem is, but that's because I'm not, you know, a genius programmer or anything. So we now have an insertion point. There's just a few more bugs to, just a few more problems rather to fix on the side of assertion wide analysis. Let's take a look at some of them. So we now have this problem with the format buffer. And that's a legitimate problem, because for the elements that we're going to be getting, we may as well create a format buffer. At the moment, I'm going to cheat, though. I'm going to basically go into the table buffer, and I'm going to sort of manufacture the buffer of a suitable size and fill it in with complete nonsense. Well, I'm going to fill it in with zeros. So private read-only, should be read-only short, rectangular array of format buffer. Okay. So I hope that the format buffer is zeroed out when you actually make one, because I'm going to make one format buffer equals new short, where the width is, of course, spec.sum ss.width, and the height is total height. That should be okay. That should be our formatting done. And then if we really want the interface, then once again we need to go into simple buffer, find format buffer, and pull members up, press return here. That's it. Now go back into the table buffer and actually implement this. Return format buffer. Okay, I think we're done. I think we're done with presenting something as a column-based thing. And the other solution-wide analysis errors are... Oh, sorry, I treat this as if it were C++. Okay, so one more error in the file, and editing, whether or not we're actually editing something. So, okay, I can live with that. So once again, simple buffer, find the editing and extract or pull members up. And then, sorry, I'm getting a bit tired of all this juggling and completely, you know, spurious kind of stuff. Inside the table buffer, once again, we go up to the top and implement this thing. So I'm not sure we need a setter, though. I don't want a setter in this particular place, maybe. So I'll get rid of the setter here. I don't think it's... let's remove the unused accessor. So table buffer can just get a false. So we'll never edit the table buffer manual. Okay, so now we have a way of rendering tables. And we may as well try that as opposed to whatever we were doing in program.cs. So how do we do it? Here's a question. First of all, I'm going to get rid of just about everything that there is in here because we have some observable intervals where we write something to the console, and you know, I don't like it generally. So let's get rid of stuff here and kind of move this back, and then I'm going to actually try making one of these table buffers and render it somehow, because remember the viewport is fine. I mean, the viewport is, you don't really need to change anything. So instead of the simple buffer, what I'm going to make is a table buffer. Table buffer, my buffer equals new table buffer, round bracket. And that's where you need to provide the spec. So if I do it like this and just provide it here, and then total height, let's have 10 rows. For example, then what I need to do is fill in some of the values, fill in some of the table specifications. So let's put in a, I hope it helps me in this regard. No. Table column spec. See, you have to use the indirection here. And once again, you specify the column. So actually, we may as well make a constructor. It could certainly be useful to have a constructor for this thing. So let's jump into the table column spec and actually generate a constructor. I'll initialize everything, but I'm going to give it values. So alignment specifically, I'm going to give table alignment a default alignment of left, because I haven't implemented the other things left yet. So that's going to be it's going to be left. All right. In the wrong place here, need to be in program. So what I'm going to do right now is just use the constructor instead. Use the constructor and provide some of the properties for that. So the header, let's try to replicate something that we've seen in the Bloomberg terminal. So I'll have the, let's have just two columns, current and change, just for the fun of it. And each of these would be, 10 characters wide. So, current is going to be 10 characters wide, and then we'll have another one. I'll just duplicate this, and we'll have this called change, like so. All right, so at the moment we're using strings to hold these things, and at some point we might upgrade it to something like, I don't know, might upgrade it to typed information, so you would have a float here or something to that effect. At the moment we're not there yet, not quite. Okay, so we've done some table column specs, and we can actually already try running it, but one thing I want to check is that everything is right. So maybe we should let's actually run this. Let's see how bad it is. We don't have time for test driven development here, right? We just want to see something working, and hopefully this runs, and you shouldn't be able to see anything like at all, because there is nothing to see. And it seems like, well, the application is just, it's on a different screen, just in case you're wondering, and it seems to have crash summarily. So I'm going to try and stop it now, which is not so easy because, well, it's a DirectX application. It's not an ordinary kind of run-of-the-mill application. So here we go. We have an exception. We have something to work with. And now we can actually investigate what is going on. And the thing that's going on is that we are hitting a null reference exception because we never even initialized any of the strings. Remember when we access the buffer, which, well, it's certainly disappointing that the buffer is empty because it shouldn't be. And that's bizarre in and of itself. I mean, the buffer, come on. Did I not put stuff in the buffer? Let's see where we are. We're in the table buffer. And if we look at the constructor, then the buffer should be initialized to... Oh, wait. Total height minus one, yeah. So the buffer should have lots of elements. And each of them should be initialized. And we still have the buffer with zero elements. What? How dare you? How dare you do this to me? Total height is set to 10. Or at least it is in this case. Okay, so we're going to begin our debugging by putting a breakpoint right inside this constructor and seeing what exactly is it being called with. So let's hit it. All right, so the total height is set to 10, and we have a spec which has two columns in it. There we go. They're all nicely initialized. So we save the spec. Okay, we set the total height. And then we set the buffer to an array. Oh, wait. Crap. Okay, so setting a buffer to a list with an initial amount is really nothing. Because then you're not... What I mean is you don't really need to... You don't really need to provide this value. Sorry, I see what's going on here. This is how real development actually works. So remove this part, get rid of this crap because the total height is completely meaningless. So we make a list. And then for each of the elements in the list, we make, we don't do it like this. Instead, we just add it. So we say buffer.add and we make a new string thingy. And this goes for not buffer count, but actually total height minus one, because the top row is kind of the row with all the headings and everything. So now we add all the elements to the buffer, and the buffer contains a bunch of string arrays, and each of those string arrays contains basically nulls. It doesn't contain anything, to be honest. That's how it goes. So and we have no real null check. So I want to run this. We should get a null reference exception at some point because I think that we're not doing any checks on the elements being not null. So let's just wait for this to run. And hopefully it's not actually such a fast process for some reason when you're debugging it this way to get that null reference exception to have it propagated. Maybe there is like a zillion calls being done all in a chain or something to that effect. So I'm sort of sitting here waiting for the whole thing to kind of propagate to the case where it says, okay, here is your null. Ah, there we go. Excellent. Fantastic. We got our null reference exception. Okay, so here's the thing. We now have a buffer, which has nine elements, each containing two strings because we have two columns. So the S here is equal to zero. However, inside we have a bunch of nulls. A bunch of nulls. No. So this is where we perform the null check. So we say... So we say this. So if buffer at y plus 1 s is not equal to null, and it has to be of sufficient length, so buffer at y plus 1 s dot length is less than, wait, no, it has to be it has to be greater than or equal to the S, X copy rather. So X copy can end up being zero, and our length has to be At least one. So yeah, greater than x copy. Then we can do the whole thing. But if x copy is too big, if it's less than or equal, then we return an empty thing, space. Like this. Okay, let's try this again. This is a lot of fun. Although I see that we've gone over 1 hour. It's like 1 hour and 13 minutes already. So I'm going to be cutting this pretty soon. But it's still crashing. I can tell you on the side screen. It's a bit disappointing that it's showing on different screens. I think that Windows, as an operating system, should learn how to keep its stuff on a, you know, remember where that window was. Okay, right. So, why are we getting no reference here? I don't like this. Okay, so y is equal to 1. So, buffer at element 2. Let's look at that. Buffer at element 2. And then s is equal to 0. So buffer at element 2 at element 0. That's... Oh, sorry. I guess this is... Here's the thing. It's when you get tired and tiredness set in and you start just doing totally silly things. So if the buffer is null, or... if the buffer length is actually less than or equal. Is this correct? Is this even right? Hey, somebody writing on Skype. How dare you write to me on Skype? Okay, one moment. Right, so if the length is less than x copy or equal to x copy, so x copy is 0, then length has to be at least 1. If it's less than or equal, then return space. Okay, we're going to try this again. This should be a lot of fun. We should see the headings, hopefully. Maybe. I don't know. I mean, you'd think you see the headings. Okay. Patience. Patience is a virtue. It's, you're just gonna wait here and see what we get. Where the no reference exception comes from next time around. Because, well, it probably will, considering the whole thing is crashing. Okay, cool. Okay, what happened here? Okay, so index was out of range. Must be no negative unless this the size of the collection. Okay, buffer. So the y value that got sent here was 8. So the buffer tried to get the 9th element. Oh, crap. How is this possible? Who's actually calling it? Let's look at the call stack. Because I suspect, yeah, it's the bloody viewport, and the viewport is attempting to return all these arbitrary locations without even checking for, like, it's the x value is 11 and the y value is 10. Well, these are legal values. We are within the you know, the proper confines. The only thing I don't like is this wrapping thing. Percent. Buffer, wait a second, what's happening here? So we take the start line, which is 0, plus the y, which is 8, plus 0, 8%, 10, which is 8. Okay, so it's actually a legal set of coordinates for our mothership to land. And what is going on? So, buffer at, so it's actually the y coordinate that's kind of creepy. The y coordinate is too big for this. So let me jump back into program and see how we can figure that. So when the viewport makes a buffer, it should probably be constrained to those coordinates, and it's not. I mean, it's just isn't. So maybe I'm put a plus where the minus should be in here. So why, wait. So if indeed y is 0, then that's the header. Otherwise, we take the y value and we... So if it's like a 1, we... Oh, yes, sorry. More mistakes. This is how it goes typically. It should be a minus everywhere. Because remember, if y is 0, then we take the header. But if y is 1, we take the 0 throw, so 1 minus 1. So that should be a minus 1. Go again. Let's just go again and see what happens here. Maybe it will finally work. Maybe something will show up. Okay, this is a sad little console because it's not rendering anything. Why is it not rendering anything? I have no idea. I mean, how would I know? It's just sitting. Oh, wait, I shouldn't shake it like this. Windows 8, damn it. You shake it and then, you know, everything. Location, let's put it here and in we are. Okay, so now we get to find out what's going on with this bit. So the x coordinate is 0. Okay. Oh, wait. No, I actually wanted to print the header of all things. I wanted to print the header, not the actual. So let's put a breakpoint on this line and continue. Okay, so x has a value of 0, y has a value of 0. We need to print the letter. What was the letter? The letter C. We should be printing the letter C right now. Right? Am I right? So let's move in. So. The spec.length has two specifications for two columns. So if spec.width is less than xcopy, and xcopy is actually 0, if 10 is less than... Okay. Did I do this the other way around? So if xcopy is greater than width, then we skip. If x copy is greater than the width, or greater or equals than the width, and x copy is 0 here. Okay. So, can we swap this around? Flip. There we go. So, this should be less than or. What about the equals? Like if it's a 5 and the width is 5. No, it has to be less. Okay, so if x copy is less than the specification width, then we print it. We get spec as header, and if, you know, the length is less than... Is this even correct? Okay, header... this should not be... Should be. Oh, wait, maybe it should be x. If the length is less than. So if x is 0, then the length has to be. And the length has to be 1. So yeah. Okay, let's try this again and remove the breakpoint. And this is how we get to find out what's actually going on and whether it's correct. Wow, look, I have the heading for, well, the first element. Where is the second element, you might ask? And I would like to know that too. Thank you very much. I would really appreciate knowing that. So, close that. Now, one of the problems I feel is that I want to stop in this point where the x value is somewhere like 11, for example. And if I put a conditional in here, that's just going to be so slow. But it has to be done. So let's put a conditional on x having the value of 11, or is it 10? No, 0 to 9 is the first 10, then x equals 10 is the second column. Press OK. And this is going to be so slow and so annoying as well. And I've already streamed 1.4 gigabytes worth of data, apparently. Okay, so X has the value of 10, which means we should skip the specification once. Let's go through it. Okay, so S equals 0. S is less than spec.length. Oh, wait. Crap, I just pressed F9 instead of F10. So let's move on. So moving on, X copy is 10 and spec width is 10. And it has to be less than. So we reduce X copy by spec width, which X copy becomes 0. And now X copy is less than spec S width. In we go. We get the header at the location S. Is the header null? Nope. Is the header length 6 less than? Crap. It is X copy here. The X is like the overall value, but this is the value that we should be taking care of. We should now see the columns. This is cool. We should now see the columns of the table. We can even color the columns later on. And it crashes again. And I'm still waiting for the exact... Oh, wait, maybe it didn't crash. Index was outside the bounds of the array. Okay. And that's because I'm being stupid again. Because it's not X here, it's X copy. God damn it. Damn it! I should do that, god damn it, you know, when in South Park, when Kenny goes, god damn it! I can't say it like this, but it's more hilarious when... When a professional voice actor says it instead of somebody who programs automated trading systems for a living. Okay, copy. There we go. Please work now. Please. Haha, we have the columns. Current and change. So you're probably wondering, well, okay, you have the columns. What about the data? How do you change the data? What do you do with it? I'm going to put in some data just for the fun of it, and move the actual thing up a bit because it's kind of, we moved it a bit down on the overall console. So let's go into, as soon as the thing lets me move anywhere, I'm going to go into Program CS and maybe change the Y coordinate. So yeah, I was going to Program CS and modify the Y coordinate for the entire thing. So because the placement of the, here is the viewport screen location and here is the Y coordinate. So let's just move it up a bit. And then at the moment, the question is, well, how do you change the data inside the buffer? And the answer is that at the moment we can try and actually assigning it, because what we effectively have, if we look at the overall thing, is, well, we're not exposing the data yet, and we should be, or at least, you know, that's useful for this exercise. So let's go into the table buffer and actually manipulate the buffer itself. I mean, it's kind of it's shown as private here, but I can expose it, buffer, like this, and now we have a public accessor for it. So we can effectively change the particular elements. So just as an example, just as a way of proving that it works, what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually go in the loop for int I equals 0. I is less than my buffer dot what we are storing the whole thing, right? Size, I guess, height, that's the number of Oh, hell, I'll just do it like this. It's not the most correct way of doing it. So for each of the data elements, what I'm going to do is I'm going to say, well, by the way, in my buffer, I'm going to take the, well, no, my buffer dot buffer, and here at position I, at zero, I'm going to have, let's have some random number generator. So random, crap, random equals new random. And then here, I'll pick, for example, random.next from 1 to 100. And the next one, and this is going to be to string, by the way, because we're still keeping things as strings. And then for the second one, or may as well just duplicate, control D this line. For the next one, I'm going to say my buffer random dot maybe next double or something. Was it next double? Yeah. To string. Is there like a format specifier for like fixed point or something? Okay, so we get to see an actual, once again, putting a breakpoint at the appropriate location and figuring out what exactly the program is trying to do. And that's going to be the last thing that we do today because, well, quite frankly, it's already 90 minutes since I'm broadcasting here, so I may as well stop at some point. Let's go into the table buffer once again. And by the way, I'm not claiming this is the most efficient table buffer ever. So let's put a breakpoint in here because that's where the data should theoretically come out. So just debug this and see what's going on. All right, so the x value is 0 and the y value is probably 1. So for each of the elements in the specification, so if the spec width is, and the spec width is 10. Oh, we made the same mistake as we did for the other one. Sorry. Flip, and I'm not going to negate because negate does it less than or equals. We just need a less than. Come on, come on, come on. And we got the values. Look, 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 look. And that is our final result, ladies and gentlemen. So what we did in this little demo is we expanded the console ecosystem to present tables of values. And hopefully at some point we can right align them and center align them and do the rest of this stuff that we are certainly capable of doing. So thank you very much for watching this broadcast, and please leave your comments if you have any comments. And that's it. Thank you, and bye-bye.